these small firms, for example, in accounts receivables and so on. And that is where we're trying to create this bill payment, bill trading facility. It's called TREDS. And we've got six or seven applications so far. We're examining them, and hopefully by November we should be able to announce a couple of platforms or more for TREDS. The truth about small business lending is it's difficult. And the answer to small business lending, in my view, is to facilitate the frameworks which allow them to borrow. So I think statements like we shouldn't take collateral from these businesses actually impede the flow of finance. There should be an easy way for them to offer collateral, which is easily registered so that it cannot be hawked to multiple players. That will allow them to borrow, and if they default, which happens sometimes, the lender should be able to repossess at low cost. That will bring down the credit spreads that have to be charged. Now, again and again, the problem in India is credit spreads are large because recovery is difficult. And what the system seems to find it difficult to understand is by easing the process of recovery, you actually reduce the cost of finance. And that is a win for everybody. So this is something that we have to work on. We have to work on through the debt recovery tribunals. We have to work on through the various courts that sometimes intervene. We have to make it easier to get finance, and this will help the poorest of the poor, the smallest of the small, the most. Now, I think the Mudra Bank has been looking at innovative ways of getting money across, but as you say, one of the biggest difficulties is equity. The problem with equity is outside equity is sort of oxymoron. Equity has to be inside. Otherwise, you have no incentive to behave. You have to have skin in the game. You have something to lose. If somebody lends you the equity, if somebody puts outside equity, then it's not really something that makes you behave. You have to have the fear of loss of money. Now, there could be co-investors if you have some money to put up. And I think some of the funds the government is thinking of could play this role. But co-investment requires a lot of hand-holding. You have to be there, you have to see what's happening, because with limited control rights, you don't want to give the money and walk away. So I think this is a very effort-intensive business. It's something that a variety of experiments are on. Banks with forming sort of hand-holding partnerships with small firms would help. We've given full priority sector possibilities right up to mid-sized firms now. But it's something that's hard across the world. It can't be wished away. And I think the worst thing in the world to do would be to send money without controls into the system, and it becomes problematic. One of the examples that we have to watch is, for example, the credit guarantee scheme we have, where the size of the NPAs is alarmingly high. Because we don't have adequate controls. So it's simply guaranteeing without adequate controls, without adequate skin in the game, without first loss for the bank that is lending, will mean a lot of money goes into areas where it could not achieve an appropriate return.
So we have just about 5 minutes, and I'll take that opportunity to ask you one last question. And this is about regulations and the fact that we seem to find that regulations are always doing a with innovation. And if you say itself, we now have these crowdfunding coming up, they are going to give you more on the deposit side, but also at a faster pace. Now, while some of these might be working on good models and a good experience, but the fact remains that once one or two of these are successful, there will be many lookalikes. And we have seen in the past also, and the most recent was Sarada and Rose Valley and things like that, that certain things seem to happen right under our noses, but we don't look at it until it sort of blows up. And somehow we find that regulations which need to predate these are not in place. Similar was the case, for instance, for the cryptocurrencies that came up. There was no regulation in place. So as a regulator, how do you deal with what is it that is required to be done so that the regulation can sort of, you know, either do a very fast action or at least ensure that the stability of the financial system is not impacted.
There are two facets to this, of course. The regulator can't be so heavy-handed that any innovation stands out. At the same time, we have to be careful that something doesn't grow big under our nose and then becomes too big to stop and then creates massive problems for the system. I would like to say that our philosophy is, if it's small, let it develop, let us see how it works, and then take a view. That was our attitude towards cryptocurrencies. It was relatively small. We put out a warning about the pitfalls of the cryptocurrency, but didn't intervene, saying that until we see some models work, we weren't convinced that the existing models were going to work. It's too much fluctuation in value to serve as currency. But new models will come. Yesterday, I had somebody in my office sort of pushing a new model of currency. We have to examine it. And I would say we shouldn't intervene too strongly until we understand it better, but we have to watch it, which means we have to be much more active in gathering market intelligence, and in situations where it's clear from the get-go that this is illegal, to bring it to the notice of law enforcement authorities if that is indeed the case. One of the things we've done over the last year is strengthen the state-level coordination committees significantly so that we can bring to them fly-by-night work to make sure that they're stopped early on by the law enforcement. And now there are subcommittees of regulators with law enforcement which are working. But we depend on the public for information. So we are trying to develop our social media sources to get information to the public about miscreants and so on. We are also looking at some of these crowdfunding issues to see whether they pose a concern. Now, one of my worries about crowdfunding is it works while the going is good.
Exactly.
But when you have to recover, because it happens, especially in an environment where enforcement is difficult and costly, as you discovered today, you know, what's going to happen? It doesn't go in without rules as to what will happen.